to the highest mountain.
Welcome to the tape ministry of the Embassy of the Word of God, where God is releasing men and women into exploits through the preaching of the word of faith. Be transformed and impacted as you listen to God's word.
Wow, welcome to this Sunday morning service. And I trust that you've had a fantastic week. I've had a fantastic week. It's been a busy week, but a week of God's goodness. If you have your Bible, why don't you lift up your Bible? Let's take the word confession and let's get into the message for today. 1, 2, shall we go? Say with me, my Bible is the word of God. It is supernatural in origin, eternal in duration, inexpressible in value, infinite in scope, regenerative in power, infallible in authority, universal in interest, personal in application, inspired in totality. I will read it through. I will write it down. I will pray it in. I will work it out and then pass it on until I become a living proof of Zion. Declare with me that this morning, as I hear the word, my heart is open, my mind is alert, and I will never be the same again because of the incorruptible seed of the word of God that will be planted into my spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you this blessed morning. And we ask, O God, that as your children are connected right now, let their spirit, O God, be open to hear your word. Not only hear your word, but also receive the ministration of the spirit. Let them, O God, be captivated. Let them be instructed. Let them be given impartation. Father, I pray, Lord, that let things change in their lives. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we have prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. Wonderful. Well, we've been looking at a series, Christian Maturity or Christian Growth. And one of the very important things we have been looking at is how to grow spiritually. And the theme for the month is, I must grow. You want to say with me? Say, I must grow. Hallelujah. Now, we said that spiritual growth is not increase in the level of the spirit that you have received as a result of being born again. But we said spiritual growth is conforming your will, your emotions, your intellect, your body, which was unregenerated at new birth, to your spirit or to the image of the spirit that is regenerated at new birth. And to do this, what we need are certain disciplines. What we need is feeding. And we say feeding is feeding on the word of God. You can't grow. You run a risk of your spiritual life if you don't feed on the word of God. That's what the scripture says in 1 Peter 2:2, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word of God, that you may grow thereby. Hallelujah. So growth is based on what you eat. Growth is based on your ability to eat. So if you don't eat, you will not grow. If you eat, you grow. Hallelujah. When you eat, you grow. And so one of the things that causes a child to grow or an individual to grow is eating, feeding. And feeding what? On the right diet. And we said the right diet is the balanced diet. And it's the balanced diet of Christ. So we feed on Christ until we come into the same unity. In Ephesians chapter 4, let's quickly go to the book of Ephesians chapter 4. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. precious name. Oh, how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 4, the verse number 11, the scripture says, it says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Verse 12 says, for the perfecting of the saints. So we said that one of the instruments of growth are your teachers. So Jeremiah 3:15 says, he says, I will give you pastors after my own heart, who shall feed you with knowledge so that you will grow. And after you have grown, you will increase. So one of the instruments for growth is your teachers, your pastor. And the Bible says he gives us these pastors in Ephesians 4 for the perfecting. The word perfecting is the word telios, is for what? It's for the maturing of the saints. Hallelujah. It's for the maturing of the saints. For one reason. For the perfecting of the saints. For the work of the ministry. So that when we mature, we can do the work of the ministry. And so, it is only mature believers that are able to do the work of the ministry. A baby has problems when he's doing the work of the ministry because he will not understand some of the sacrifices and some of the things that is expected of him as a baby Christian. And that's why we must grow. So the role of your pastor is to teach you so that you grow. For the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, so that the church of God or the body of Christ can be edified or be built up or be encouraged. Hallelujah. Can be encouraged. Verse 13. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. And we said the unity of the faith here is Christ. That's the diet. The balanced diet in the New Testament is Christ. We are supposed to feed essentially on Christ. And that is what the epistles major on. They major on growth, spiritual growth. Hallelujah. The edifying of the body of Christ. So we all come in the unity of the faith. And we said the unity of the faith is who? Christ. And of the knowledge of the Son of God. Unto a perfect man. So that you can become or be formed in the image of the perfect man. And the perfect man is who? A mature man. And the perfect man here is the image of Christ. The image of Christ. Unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that you come to that place of the fullness of Christ, that place of the measure. So when they see you, they see Christ. When they see you, they can say, this is a Christian. You are a Christian because you are Christ, the manifestation of Christ on the earth today. And it says, verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children. So one of the things that happen to children is that they are tossed to and fro. And that's what the scripture says. Tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. And so the teachings, when you are moved by every wind of teaching, you are still a babe. If you have not come to the place where you know the voice of your teacher and you can hear the voice of your teacher and grow thereby, you are a babe. And so we come to the place of maturity where we have grown into the image of Christ. Not children tossed to and fro. Children are tossed to and fro. That you are not tossed to and fro or deceived or waver. Hallelujah. And carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. So there are men out there that have not been sent but are on an assignment, and the assignment is to deceive. And they can deceive. Some are sincere, but they are sincere in their deception because they have not completely learned Christ. And so they cannot minister what they don't have. Verse 15, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him. So we grow up into him. We grow up into a person. We grow up into his image. In all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth. So when we come to that place of full maturity, every joint in the body begins to supply. We all become suppliers in the house of God. We are suppliers of what is lacking in the house of God. We are suppliers of the needs in the house of God. So we begin to grow. Hallelujah. Every joint supplier according to the effectual working. So when we are supplying, we must not just supply. We are supplying effectively what is lacking in the body. So some are supplying resources, finances. Some are supplying prayer. Some are supplying emotional health. Some are supplying all kinds of things in the body so that we all grow into Christ. Hallelujah. The effectual working in the measure of every part. So every part is measured by their level of effectiveness. And you are a measure. You have a measure. You have a joint that you need to supply. But you cannot supply it effectively, or you cannot be effective in your supply in the body of Christ if you don't grow. That's why I am teaching and very heavy on spiritual growth. It's a subject that is actually left untaught, but it's a subject that will help every believer, especially if you want to supply what you need to supply in the body. The reason is simple, because after all is done, when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, we shall give account of what we have done in the body. In the body of what? The body of Christ. Not in your body, your physical body, but in the body of Christ. And this is what brings about rewards. And we don't want you to be ashamed when you get there. Praise God. The measure of every part maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Hallelujah. So that is why we emphasize spiritual growth, for increase, for growth. And so we said that one of the things that causes a man to grow is their feeding, what they eat. The next thing we said was how they breathe. If you breathe, you will grow. So today we want to look at prayer as a necessity for spiritual growth. Prayer as a necessity for spiritual growth. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, the verse number 17. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. Just as every human being does not cease to breathe, we also cease not to what? To pray. So prayer is like air to the believer that must grow. So every believer that ought to grow, one of the first things that they are taught is prayer. Prayer. The concept of prayer runs through all scripture. It runs from the Old Testament to the New Testament. But most of the time, because it's not taught well, many people just gloss over it. But the necessity of prayer is very important for the livelihood of the believer. You cannot grow without prayer. You will suffocate and die spiritually if your prayer life is out of sync. And that is why the concept of prayer is very important and must be taught, and is taught all throughout scripture. Hallelujah. So we teach prayer by precept and also by practice. We teach prayer by precept and by practice. Now let's look at Luke chapter number 11, the verse number 1. And let's examine how Jesus taught his disciples, or how they desired to know how to pray. The scripture says, and it came to pass that as he was praying, Jesus was praying. In John 1:1, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In the verse number 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among men, among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father. Hallelujah. As the only begotten of the Father. So, full of grace and truth. Jesus, as God incarnate, is the person that should not even think of prayer, because that is God. But the Bible says he became flesh, dwelt among men, and also desired to pray. And he prayed very often. So we see in Luke 11 here, and it came to pass that as he was praying, as he was what? Praying in a certain place. So when it comes to prayer, there is a set time for prayer, and there is a place for prayer. There are places where we pray, and there are set times of prayer. Hallelujah. He was praying at a certain place. When he ceased, or when he stopped praying, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, or Master, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. So John has been noted for teaching what? His disciples. So these ones were also asking, Lord, teach us to pray. The word disciple there is the word for a student. one that follows certain set of laid down principles. It was derived from another word which implies to learn, to be accustomed to a principle or what? A practice. So disciples are people that are accustomed to a discipline or a practice. And so they want to learn the practice of prayer. And so they said, teach us to pray. So prayer can be taught. We have established that we exercise prayer in a place and set times. We are also establishing here that prayer can be taught. Prayer is taught in precept and also in what? Practice. And that's what we're going to do today. Philemon chapter 1, the verse number 6, the scripture says that we should be able to acknowledge every good thing that is in us in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. So on the subject of prayer, effectiveness is very, very important. And what are we effective about? We are effective about the teaching of the word of God. Hallelujah. We must be effective. Philemon 1:6 says that the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledging. The word acknowledging there means to have complete epignosis of every good thing which is in me in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. The sharing or the participation of our faith. So our prayer is actually fellowship. What is prayer? Somebody say prayer is communication between God and man. That is not entirely correct or complete. It is quite correct, but not completely correct, because prayer is fellowship. The New Testament uses a Greek word for prayer, which is very, very instructive. It is the word prosukomaia. Prosukomaia. And prosukomaia means to come into face to face, to be in face to face. So in John 1:1, we see that in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God. It means the word was in the face of God. The word was in fellowship with God. So even in the Godhead, they have what we call fellowship, or what, to an extent, what we will call what? Prayer. So fellowship means a participation, a drinking together. Philemon says the effectiveness of that fellowship, of that sharing together, will come into effect through our complete knowledge. So what we know about prayer is very important. It determines how we pray and what we pray. Hallelujah. It determines what we pray and how we pray. Prayer is communication, or prayer is fellowship, a drinking together, where we are in the face of God. And that is why there are different kinds of prayer. A prayer is not just talking to God. You may talk to God and that may be prayer, but listen to this. In Malachi chapter number 3, we'll find here in Malachi chapter 3 that there is a form of prayer that is here that is different from what we know. Hallelujah. From verse 13, the scripture says, your words have been harsh against me, says the Lord. Yet you say, what have we spoken against you? You have said it is useless to serve God. What profit is it that we have kept his ordinance and that we have walked as mourners before the Lord of hosts? So now we call the proud blessed, for those who do wickedness are raised up. They even tempt God and go free. Then those who feared the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord listened. So they were speaking to one another, but God what? Listened. That is prayer. They were communicating to one another, but God what? Listened. So sometimes even communicating with one another can be prayer, because people may be listening. That's why somebody can say, hey, my leg, I can feel that pain in my leg. He is communicating with the elements of the universe. He's communicating with God. He's communicating with entities, the supernatural. And so what happens is that the moment he said, hey, my leg, what he is communicating is he's inviting demons to begin to release pain into that leg. And so not too long, you find out that the leg is becoming one kind. And he is thinking that it is a devil that is doing him. He prayed it. He says, as they were speaking one to another, God, the Lord listened and heard them. So a book of remembrance was written before him for those who fear the Lord. based on what they were saying. That was what was put in the book of remembrance, based on their complaints. So sometimes we complain and we think that that is not prayer. It is prayer. That's why the scripture says, do not murmur. When we murmur, we are actually praying, because we are speaking words that are not consistent with what the word of God has said concerning us in the ears of God. That is why the scripture says in the New Testament, do all things without what? Murmuring. When we murmur, it is a form of prayer, but it is prayer that is negative. Hallelujah. So there is one is positive prayer and negative prayer. Hallelujah. He says, now listen to this. He says, so a book of remembrance was written before him for those who fear the Lord and who meditate on his name. So even meditating on the name of the Lord is prayer. So prayer is not always sitting down and speaking. Prayer is not always sitting down and talking, because we think that when we are not talking, we are not praying. And that's why a lot of us think that we are not praying, or we don't pray, or we feel lazy to pray. But it is, every prayer is not the same. There are prayers that are prayed just out of the meditation of our heart. There are prayers that are prayed within the midst of silence. Your heart is praying. In the midst of silence, your mind is praying. In the midst of silence, your body is communicating to God, and it is a form of prayer. Prayer is not just all the time, Iago, Azeleba, Abadie, Ezogobo, Agaba, where you make noise without any connection with heaven. What makes prayer prayer is when our heart is connected. Hallelujah. When our heart is connected. Let's look at the book of James, chapter number 5. So prayer must have a heart connection. James chapter 5, the verse number 16 downwards. The scripture reads, it says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another. The word prayer is being used here. And it says that you may be healed. Confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Then it gives us the content of that prayer. It says the effective. So the prayer that is effective must also be what? Fervent. And it says the effectual, or the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Avails much, or makes what? Power available. Prayer does not give power, but prayer makes power available. I'm saying something very instructive here. Prayer does not give power, but prayer makes what? Power available. How does prayer make power available? We have become the headquarters of God. We are the house of God. So the power of God is resident in us via the word of God that is resident in our heart. So how do we make that power available? Or how do we channel that power to begin to create things and do things in our aeon? The way we do that is when we begin to engage the forces of prayer within us. Then we make that power available, or we supply the spirit from our spirit to cause things to begin what? To change. And that is why somebody can just stay and meditate on something, and after a while, you begin to see that things begin to change and to favor him. Yet he never spoke a word. What he did was that his heart was connected to that prayer. He says the effectual, fervent prayer. The word fervent there is heartfelt. So prayer must have a heart connection. Prayer must have, your faculties must be involved in prayer for it to become effective. Prayer must have focus. And also, prayer is based on your stand and your status before God. The effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous man. Who is a righteous man? A righteous man is simply somebody who is born again. Let's look at the book of Romans chapter 5, the verse number 1. Hallelujah. I'm beginning to get excited now. That is why you can't say you cannot pray, and you can't say you don't know how to pray. If you are taught to pray right, you will pray well, and you will pray without even getting tired. Hallelujah. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5 from verse 1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So justification through faith is what declares a man righteous. A man is not righteous because he does righteous acts. A man is made righteous because he has been justified. The word justified there means simply declared not guilty. Not declared not guilty means that man can stand before God without any condemnation, or without a heart of what? Condemnation. It means that man has received what we call forgiveness. It means that man, by the love of God, through faith in Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, has received a new stand and a new status before God. He has been declared not guilty. Romans 5 verse 12 says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not what imputed where there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. Verse 15, but not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, has abounded unto many. Verse 16, and not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For of what? Many offenses unto what? Justification. Verse 17. For if by one man's offense death reigned, by one, much more they which receive. So what do you receive? Abundance of grace and of what? The gift of righteousness. That is being declared not guilty. The Bible says, the moment you are saved, you have a right before God. You have a standing before God. So you don't go to the throne room of grace only when you are in trouble. The only time you pray is when you are in trouble. It simply means you are really, really in trouble. And so every time, every day of our life, we need to cultivate the attitude of prayer. We need to cultivate the attitude of prayer. Hallelujah. We need to cultivate the attitude of prayer. Let's quickly look at a few scriptures to establish prayer as a fellowship and how we need to engage that attitude of prayer and what we need to pray about. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 5, the verse number 44. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use and persecute you. So when it comes to prayer, prayer is targeted towards God, but it is so that you can supply the Spirit of God to help the needs of men and even your own circumstances. So anytime we pray, we supply the Spirit. And that is why most at times prayer is not without supplication. And we'll be looking at that word in a moment. Prayer is not without supplication. Now, let's look at Philippians chapter 1, verse 9. And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment. This I pray. Paul is telling us that in my fellowship with the Father, I pray that your love may abound. These are the contents of what we pray. He's praying for the brethren in Philippi, and he's praying that their love will abound. That should be at the content of our prayer. When we pray for the brethren, we pray for even those that spitefully use us, even though they have wronged us, because it is a fellowship to supply the Spirit to help. We engage the Spirit of God, and we do it not from that place of condemnation, but we do it from that place of what? A right standing, so that the Spirit of God can help. Hallelujah. So that the Spirit of God can help. He's praying that the Spirit of God will engage, or will fill these people with love. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 18. It says, praying always. I told you in the beginning that there are different times of prayer. The scripture says we should pray how many times? Always. Always. That means that you can pray every time. And praying every time does not mean that all the time your voice is so loud, but wherever you are, at every moment in time, at every place in time, you can find time to pray. You can pray for 5 minutes. You can pray for 10 minutes. But there shouldn't be more than 10 minutes in between the first time you prayed and the next time you pray that you have not prayed. It is said that Smith Wigglesworth will always pray every day 15 minutes, but there will not be any 15 minutes that will pass without Smith Wigglesworth praying. So every 15 minutes, he is praying. By the time there is a break in between the next 15 minutes and the next 15 minutes, he has started another session of prayer. And so he is not praying for maybe 100 hours or 10 hours continuously without engaging his strength. But every 15 minutes is praying. And so it is without effort. He does it effortlessly. He does it from his heart. He does it consciously. And he does it what? Consistently. And he does it with his heart involved. And so even though there are short spaces of time, he is accruing to his spiritual account, to his spiritual bank account, prayer. And so he is never spiritually bankrupt. That is why was also able to demonstrate much power. The Bible says, praying always. So we can pray always. We can pray every time. We can pray consistently. We can pray methodically. We can pray in a systematic way. Praying always with all prayer. And then it says what? Supplication. The word supplication here means entreaty. It means to beg before a higher authority. I told you earlier on that we'll talk about supplication. There is no prayer that doesn't go without what? Supplication, because you are praying before God. And so almost of our prayers or all of our prayers comes with supplication. We are supplicating to who? To God. God as who? As our Father. I will be ending with the fact that we must come into that place of Father consciousness when it comes to praying to God. The reason is simple. When Jesus taught the disciples to pray, he says, pray in this manner, our Father who art in heaven. In other words, Jesus was saying that when it comes to praying to God, you must see God as what? Your Father. In other words, there is a relationship. There is a fellowship. And so there is a koinonia, a drinking together, a participation. You are not coming to God as somebody that is coming to beat you down. You are coming to God as your Father. And so you can pour your heart out to him as your Father. Praise the Lord. It says, with all prayer. So there are different kinds of prayer and supplication in the spirit. Prayer is a spiritual exercise. When we say it's a spiritual exercise, it means you must engage your spirit. You don't engage only your intellect. You engage your spirit. Your spirit means you engage your heart. Being watchful for this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. And what do we pray for? We pray for saints, the saints. We pray for believers. And for me, we pray for our pastor that utterance may be given to me. So Paul is saying that in the midst of prayer, one of the things we must pray for is we must pray for the saints. Another group of people we pray for is we pray for pastors and ministers of the gospel so that utterance will be given to them, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Hallelujah. For which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. So you pray for your pastor, and when you are praying for your pastor, you are praying and you are declaring. I told you when you teach prayer, you teach it by precept and by what? Practice. How do you pray? You lift up your voice and lift up your hands. I taught you on the protocol of lifting up of hands in the court of heaven, and you declare in the name of Jesus, I pray for my man of God, that Father, utterance is granted him, that as he speaks boldly. So what I'm teaching you now is to pray by example. And so you declare in the name of Jesus, as my pastor preaches, Lord, Lord, he will speak the right words. Lord, you will put the right words in his mouth. He will speak boldly the gospel of Christ. He will declare the gospel of Christ with boldness. The scripture says we should pray for the saints. What do you pray for the saints? We saw earlier on Philippians, you pray that the love of God will abound in the hearts of the saints. So you declare in the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord, for the saints of God, that the love of God will fill their heart, that they will be grounded in love, they will be established in love. This is how you pray. You establish the brethren in love, that none will walk in selfishness. We decree and declare that selfishness will not find its way into their heart. We decree and declare that bitterness will not find its way into their heart. We decree and declare that the saints are walking in love. They are walking in unity of purpose in the name of Jesus. This is how we pray. Hallelujah. And when we pray like this, we make power available. The power to cause the saints to walk in love is released towards them. What we are doing is we are supplying the Spirit. I said supplication is what? The supply and application of the Spirit of God in the place of fellowship. Hallelujah. And this is how we pray. Colossians chapter 1. Let's look at Colossians chapter 1 verse 3. It says, we give thanks to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So he is directing his prayer to who? God. And he calls God Father. So Father, he had told you earlier on, when God is being addressed in the place of prayer, you must come with the consciousness of fatherhood. You must come with the consciousness that you're having fellowship with your Father. So he says, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So anytime we pray, we also pray what we call prayers of thanksgiving. Oh, Father, I thank you. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for the brethren. I thank you for every single person that is around me. Thank you, Heavenly Father. As we thank him, the Bible says, praying always for you. So when you are praying for the brethren, don't stop praying. When what you want to see happen in the life of the brethren has not yet happened, you don't stop praying. You keep praying. And when you keep praying like this, what happens is that God supplies the Spirit. The help of the Holy Ghost is released on their behalf. You make power available, and that power goes ahead to begin to cause what you want to see in the life of those people, in the life of a certain region, in the life concerning any particular issue, to begin to amend. Hallelujah. To begin to amend and to begin to find what? To find focus and direction. It says, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of your love for all the saints, because of the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, of which you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which has come to you, as it has also in all the world, and is bringing forth fruit, as it is also among you since the day you heard and knew the grace of God in truth. He says the gospel is bringing forth what? Fruits. And how does fruit come forth? Fruit comes forth through prayer. It comes forth through prayer. It comes forth through prayer. And it is men that pray. Men pray. We see in that same James we read earlier on, James chapter 5, the verse number 16. So men are the ones that pray. Prayer is an instruction for every believer. So when you don't pray, you are in disobedience. When you don't pray, you have come to that place where you are not relying on God. Because we rely on God. We rely on God, and the power of God is only made available in the place of prayer, in the place of what? Fellowship with the Father. In the place of fellowship with the Father. And I told you that prayer is not just talking. You can talk in prayer, but you can also think in prayer. You can meditate in prayer. Hallelujah. Anytime you stay in that place of quietness and your mind and your heart is connected to heaven and you are pouring out the petitions of your heart, in essence, what you are doing is you are praying. Hallelujah. And you need to determine times of prayer. Prayer is not a gift of the Holy Spirit. Prayer is not part of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Prayer is a discipline and a practice. We saw earlier on the disciples wanted to be taught how to pray. And as disciples, they were being taught laid down principles. And so prayer is also one of the laid down principles that is laid down for every believer. From the day you became declared righteous and you became born again, the first thing you need to learn to do is to pray. How do you pray? You pray by communicating your heartfelt needs to the Father concerning issues, concerning people, concerning ministers of the gospel, concerning the church of God. How do you do it? You do it in the place of utterance to the Father. You also do it with what? With the meditations of your heart, or even with your thinking. With your thinking. Now listen to this in Ephesians chapter 3, the verse number 20. Oh, glorious Father, glorious God, beautiful King, Excellent God, we bow before your throne. Glorious, glorious God, beautiful King. Excellent God, we bow before your throne. Oh, bow before your throne. Worship at your feet. Likarababo shetele babaha. Bow before your throne. You are the glorious God. Let me finish the scripture that come back to James. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20. The scripture says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think. So what we ask is prayer. What we think is prayer. According to the power that worketh in us. And where is the power? Resident where? In us. So the power of God that is inside us, stored in us, must be released. The channel for the release of that power inside of us is through the place of what? Prayer. And prayer is based on our meditations of the heart. It's based on what we speak, what we ask. So you can pray with your legs. You can pray with every part of your body. You can even pray with your eyes. You can pray with some part of your body. You can concentrate your fellowship with the Father with some parts of your body. And that is prayer. That's prayer. But I told you earlier on that men pray. Men pray. This is the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And I told you who a righteous man is. And he says that person's prayer, the word avail there means makes power available or makes miracle working power available. So the miracle working power of God that Ephesians 3:20 says is within us is dispensed through the place of what? Prayer. To the place of prayer. And how is it dispensed? He gives us now an example of a man that prayed. Elijah was a man. I told you, men pray. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. Elijah was a man that eats, that sleeps, that was busy. You cannot be too busy to pray. He says Elijah was like us. He had the same nature as us. In other words, Elijah was a busy man. He was doing all the things that we do on daily basis. But the Bible says something. And he prayed. So you can pray as well. How did he pray? Earnestly, that it will not rain. Now, I will explain the word earnestly there. Earnestly there means he prayed continuously. He prayed without stopping. He prayed continuously, insistently. And he prayed, the Bible says, prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. So he prayed so that the elements can be stopped. You can pray and have dominion over the elements. The reason is this. You see, anytime we pray, we come into contact. We make contact with the elements that created the universe. We make contact with the supernatural. Anytime we pray, we make contact with heaven. We make contact with God that causes things to happen the way God wants them to happen. So when we don't pray, we allow things to go the way that devil wants them to happen. So we can change the course of events. We can change the elements. We can stop things from happening when we pray. The scripture says our prayer makes power available. In other words, it supplies power. Our prayer brings supplication available. The supply and application of the spirit. Mangoleka shatala bahaya. Indolobo shika babahora. Ilasukla tekla tele bahaya. You can't sit and not pray. You can pray with your mouth closed and you are praying. The Bible says Hannah was in the temple and mouth was only moving, but nothing came out of her mouth, yet she was praying from her heart. Eli the prophet saw her and said, look woman, why are you so drunk this early morning in the temple? The woman said, man of God, I'm not drunk as you suppose. I'm not drunk, but my heart is heavy. and I have so much on my heart that I cannot even utter it. I cannot even speak it. I can only mumble it. I can only meditate it. And the prophet said, let it be according to what you desired. A year after, the woman came back to Shiloh with a baby. And she prayed, the prayer she prayed was, Father, if you give me a child, I will give this child back to you. The heaviness of her heart, even though it did not come out in audible words, but God heard the meditation of the heart of the woman, and Samuel, the great prophet, was born out of the meditation of that prayer. So there are different kinds of prayer. You cannot be there and not pray. You are praying every time, whether you know it or not. When you sit down and you think on negative things, you draw negative things into your atmosphere. It is a form of prayer, but the only thing you invite is the devil. So that is why when you sit down and you want to think, meditate on good thoughts. The Bible says when you think on this thing, think on things that are lovely, things that are trustworthy, things that are of good report. Because when you do this, you engage the forces of heaven to begin to draw these things into your atmosphere. There are some people, they don't talk, they are very quiet, but no good thing happens to them. And you wonder why? Because the meditations of their heart are always filled with negative things and things that must not happen to them, things they cannot see is happening to them, and they complain and murmur in their heart, even though they are not speaking it. What they don't know is that they are engaging the forces of hell to bring those things into their life. And so meditation of your heart is also prayer. And that's why no man can sit and say he doesn't pray. You pray, but you may be praying negatively. But that is why we must pray. And when you are praying, be conscious about it. And that scripture said that he prayed what? Earnestly. He prayed earnestly. 1 Kings 18 from verse 41 to 44 gives us an insight to how Elijah prayed. The Bible said Elijah prayed once, went back, prayed the second time, went back, prayed the third time. Elijah prayed consistently until Elijah saw the hand of God, saw God move, and it began to rain. So it is not just like Elijah went and came and said, oh, in the name of Jesus, rain, don't come. No, the Bible says he earnestly, he prayed continuously. If you want to see results, you must not stop. You must keep praying. And your prayer must be consistent. Your prayer must be continuous. Hallelujah. Your prayer must be ceaseless. Your prayer must be what? Ceaseless and continuous. Let's look at a few scriptures to establish this before I bring my submission to a close. Romans chapter 12, the verse number 12. Let's read that. Romans chapter 12, verse 12. The scripture says, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation. It says continuing instant in prayer. So prayer is something we continue in. Prayer is something that must be continuous, instant, continuous, instant, continuous. Our attitude in prayer is instant and continuous. We don't stop. We keep praying. We don't stop. We keep praying. Whether we see change or not, you don't stop. You keep praying until the change comes. Hallelujah. It says must be instant and continuous. Hallelujah. Let's look at Colossians chapter 4, the verse number 2. Korima kasa talala bahaya in koleba. It says continue earnestly in prayer. Continue how? Earnestly. It means continue steadfastly, not stopping. Don't let your fervor be short-circuited. Luke 18 verse 1, Jesus said that in that parable, he says that men ought to always pray and not to faint. To pray earnestly means to pray always. It means breathe prayer, eat prayer. Let prayer be your breath. Just as we cannot stop breathing, because if we stop breathing, we die. The same way when you stop praying, you die spiritually. And so prayer causes us to grow. It's a catalyst for growth. It's a catalyst for growth. Hallelujah. A believer who doesn't pray lives in disobedience. And what you are simply saying is that, look, I don't care what happens. I don't care what happens, but you must care. Because whether you pray or not, something will happen. And it will be something you don't like. And so pray and channel the outcome of what you want to see. Don't sit there and give up without praying. Pray. Let's look at a few things in scripture about insistent and consistent prayer. And then I bring my submission to a close. Le kopra kato le makaya da baha. Ien kato to dobo bobo bo shita. Acts chapter 12, the verse number 5. It says, Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing. Prayer was made without what? Ceasing. Oh, makala babahaya. James was killed by Herod, and by the same vein he saw that he pleased the people, and so they put Peter as well in jail, about to kill him. But the disciples prayed. The saints went to gather together in the room, in one room, and they prayed. And as they prayed, the Bible says the place shook. As they prayed, an angel was dispatched. There are angelic forces that are available, ready to act on our behalf. But until we engage the force of prayer that is trapped within us, we cannot see the angels working on our behalf. They are there, not being activated. Your angels are activated in the place of prayer. Miracles are activated in the place of prayer. We must pray. And how do we pray? Ceaselessly. The Bible says, Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God. I told you we pray to who? God. And God is who? The Father. For him. So you can intercede, you can supply. So these guys were supplying the Spirit. Peter is at a place where he cannot pray. He's at a place where he is despondent. He's at a place where he has used up his prayer credit. That is why praying consistently helps you to store up energy and prayer power. Because there are certain seasons in your life when you may not have the ability to pray as consistent as you used to pray. And that's why when you have the time to pray, especially in this COVID period, is a time to contact heaven. Verse 6. And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night, somebody said the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hands. And the angel said unto him, get thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he said unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true, which was done by the angel, but thought he was in a vision. He thought he was dreaming. Halokosotoba. That is what prayer can do. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through the one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him. And when Peter was come to himself, he said, now I know of a surety that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me out of the hand of Herod. Ah, there are wicked and unreasonable men that are out there. Paul says that pray for me that I will be delivered from wicked and unreasonable men. For all men do not have faith. There are certain times what you need is the deliverance from wicked men. There are sometimes you need deliverance from unreasonable men. There are men that are bent on using certain laws to oppress and to suppress and to hinder people and their destinies. And these are the people we need deliverance from. Sometimes you need deliverance from people. You need deliverance from wicked men. He says, pray for me. Sometimes the prayer you are praying for somebody, you don't know that it is delivering that person from wickedness that has been programmed for that person. Sometimes people have been programmed for wickedness, and they don't know it themselves. They have been trapped. They are in a place where they cannot help themselves. But our prayer makes power available. The Bible says the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous man causes miracle working power to be made available. Anytime we pray, we cause power to be released. Power is released to change things. Power is released for people to be delivered. Power is released for people to be set free. Peter was set free whilst the church continued to pray. How did they pray? Earnestly. They prayed continuously. They prayed without stopping. They prayed every second. They will rise up and pray. They prayed for some time. I believe they never prayed all throughout. They will pray. They will rest a little while and they will continue praying. They said, no, Peter must not die like James. If we stay, Peter will die. But we must not see Peter die. We must not see that issue continue the way it is. We must not see unrighteousness continue to go on the way it is. We can pray for our cities. We can pray for men. We can pray for women. We can pray for wombs. We can pray for lives. We can pray for destinies. And things can change. The Bible says Isaac prayed for the wife and the wife conceived. We can pray. We can pray. We must not sit down and watch until things go bad before we begin to pray. It will be too late. This is the time to pray. This is the time to rise up. This is the time to say, no, we will not keep quiet. We have power stored within us, but this power can be quenched when our mouth is shut, when our heart is shut, when we don't petition heaven, but we can pray. Hallelujah. I say we can pray. Acts chapter 13. Let's read a few scriptures on praying. Then we'll begin to pray now. Acts chapter 13 from the verse number 1. Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene and Manion, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted. So sometimes when your prayer is not making the necessary inroads, you add fasting. Give yourself to fasting and give yourself to what? To fasting and separate yourself unto prayer. Jesus, at certain times, we may not be able to have time to read all of that, but Jesus at certain times will separate himself from people and will go and pray. This is what Jesus did. Jesus, the Son of God, sometimes will separate himself from people to give himself to what? Prayer. So prayer is a lifestyle. Prayer is an art we can learn. Prayer is something we can engage in. Jesus prayed at different times. He prayed all night. Matthew 26, 39 to 44. The Bible says Jesus prayed all night. Mark 14, 32 to 39. Jesus prayed all night. Luke 22, 41 to 44. Jesus prayed what? All night. Jesus sometimes will separate himself from people to give himself to prayer. Mark 6, 46. We see Jesus praying, then separating himself and praying. We see Matthew 14, 23. Jesus separating himself and praying. Take note of these scriptures and go and study them. Jesus prayed. He will wake up early. Luke chapter 5, verse 16. The Bible says Jesus woke up early in the morning and will separate himself to go and pray. So early morning prayer, set time to pray. You can pray early in the morning. You can pray during the day. You can pray at night. But set a set time for prayer. Set a place for prayer. You can set a place for prayer where you can have communication, where you will not be, your attention will not be divided. But you can also pray everywhere. Paul says that I wish that all men will lift up their holy hands, praying in every place. Hallelujah. So in the place of prayer, there is a place of kneeling down. There is a place of lifting up holy hands. There is a place of there are different postures of prayer which cannot be covered in just this. It has to take a whole series. But I'm just giving you a foretaste of what it means to pray and what prayer can do to your spiritual growth. The Bible says these people ministered to the Lord and fasted. Then the Holy Ghost said, so they prayed, but they also had fasted. And then the Holy Ghost spoke and said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. But listen to this. And when they had fasted and prayed, when they had fasted and prayed, they laid hands on them. So sometimes the time we pray is when we are ordaining people or we are setting them forth for a work or for a holy work. We fast and we pray for them and we release them or we dispatch them. Hallelujah. So we see this happening here in the church. So prayer takes place, number one, in the church. Prayer can also take place in your private place, in your holy place, where you gather by yourselves to pray. Acts chapter 14, the verse number 21 to 23, I read. It says, and when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and Antioch, confirming the souls. The word confirming them means strengthening the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue. To continue what? In the faith. And that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. And when they had ordained them elders in every church and had prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord on whom they believed. When they have prayed with what? Fasting. The work of the ministry is spiritual. And so because it is spiritual, we need to engage the forces of heaven. the end. They prayed for them. They prayed for them. They prayed for them. This is now an opportunity. You have an opportunity now to pray. And don't say that you don't know how to pray. Don't say that I can't pray. You can pray and you will know how to pray. I want to give you one content of what to pray and how to pray, and then let's begin to pray. So rise to your feet now as we begin to talk to the Lord in Ephesians. Makonde kleskelala tu saliante ketosa. In Ephesians chapter 1 from the verse number 15, I beg your pardon. Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you. So part of our prayer is to give thanks. How do we give thanks? You lift up your voice with me and declare, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the saints. I thank you for every believer, wherever they are, in whatever situation. I thank you, Lord, that your grace is abounding in their lives, that they have been established in your love, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Then you begin to lift up your voice and begin to pray in tongues. Father, I thank you for the saints. I thank you for establishing them, oh God, in the love. I thank you, Daddy God, for establishing them in the gospel. I thank you, Lord, for establishing them. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for their lives. It says, making mention of you in my prayers. You can mention the names of the saints, of the believers. You mention the names. You mention names like Justice. I pray for you in the name of Jesus that you will grow in the knowledge of God. I pray for you, Ty, that you will grow in the knowledge of God. In lo sobra katole manda in kalando close kelelebeha in lo sotaya. I pray for you, Samuel, that you will grow in the knowledge of God. You will grow in the love of God. I pray for you, Emma, that you will grow in the knowledge. And you mention names like this, and you pray for them. The verse 17 says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may grant to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, so you can pick the same names that you have prayed for. Oh, I pray for you, Shiloh. I pray for you, Shiloh, and I declare in the name of Jesus that you will grow in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you will grow. The Lord grants you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Christ in the mighty name of Jesus. I pray for you, Shiloh. I pray for you, Kamel. I decree and declare in the name of Jesus that the Lord grants you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. Then you begin to pray. You lift up their names as you pray like this, and you pray. You are making power available. You are decreeing in the name of Jesus. You are establishing the faith. You are establishing the love of God. You are declaring in that the eyes of your understanding will be enlightened. You are declaring in the name of Jesus, Shiloh, your eyes are flooded. The eyes of your understanding is flooded with light. It's flooded with the light, with understanding. In the name of Jesus, I pray for you. Rejoice that the eyes of your understanding is flooded with light. I pray for you, testimony, that the eyes of your understanding is flooded with light. This is how you pray. I taught you earlier on that you pray by precept and by example. So you pick these examples that I'm giving you right now. This is how you pray. You are declaring in the name of Jesus that the eyes of your understanding are enlightened. Oh, Rabba Satala Babahaya Lebro Shetelia Stephanie, I pray for you that the eyes of your understanding are being enlightened right now in the name of Jesus. Le Kalababahando, I pray for you, Sabella. I declare in the name of Jesus that the eyes of your understanding are being enlightened. You are having understanding in the name of Jesus. You are getting to know the hope of your calling. Illo sopra tala mande repa suto lobo bonda lika parada dabaha izola bababa. I decree and declare that the power of God is working on your behalf. The power of God is producing in you mazonde lelebea patience. It's producing in you patience. It's producing you the fruit of the spirit of joy in the name of Jesus. You lift up your voice and declare, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for Chichi, I pray for Chigozia, that the eyes of the understanding have been enlightened in the name of Jesus. I decree and declare, I pray for you, Grace, that the eyes of your understanding is being enlightened in the knowledge of Christ in the name of Jesus. You are standing strong, you will not be weak. Then you begin to lift up their names and begin to pray and decree and declare in the name of Jesus. I pray for you, Martina. I declare that you are delivered from unreasonable men. You are delivered from wicked schemes. You are delivered from every satanic scheme in the name of Jesus. Paul said, a door, an effectual door has been opened unto me, but there are many adversaries. Therefore, you begin to declare in the name of Jesus. Romuald, I pray for you that every adversary around you is scattered in the name of Jesus. We scatter every adversary of the enemy concerning your life in the name of Jesus. Every scheme of the enemy, I declare and I decree, they come one way, but they flee seven ways in the name of Jesus. You are protected and you are defended. Oh, Rabba Satala Baba Bahaya, Iko Rabba Baba Kotoya. I pray for you, Jonas. I decree and I declare that every assignment of hell concerning your life is destroyed right now in the name of Jesus. I decree and I declare the power of God is made available concerning you, and every prophecy released concerning your life is receiving speedy manifestation in the name of Jesus. This is how you pray. You decree and declare in the name of Jesus. Ah, lo so prate ketaya. I pray for you, Stephen. I decree and declare that the power of God is working through you and in you. It's producing in you strength and vitality. I pray for you, Rhoda. I decree and I declare in the name of Jesus that the Lord is granting unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. I decree and declare that you are delivered from wicked and unreasonable men, from traps of the enemy in the mighty name of Jesus. Then you declare over their lives, as a bird you have escaped from the snare of the fowler. As a bird you have escaped from the snare of the fowler. Then you pray in tongues. Maso la baba. The scripture says praying all prayer in the spirit. So you lift up your voice and pray in tongues. Moso man de kleskuli baroshata ikora baba sotele bebea indololo bobobobosha itala baba. I decree and declare that the enemy is resisted on your behalf. This is how you pray. This is how you pray. This is how you make the supply of the spirit available. And this is how you grow. As you pray for others, you find out that yourself, your life begins to take on ascendancy. Your life begins to make progress. Your life begins to get improved. And this is how you grow. Hallelujah. Have you received that word? If you have received that word, stretch forth your hands towards the gadgets you are using right now, whether the television or the tablet, whatever you're using. Let me pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, we make power available. We make the supply of the spirit available in the name of Jesus. We release angelic activity just as angels were released on behalf of Peter. Lord, in the name of Jesus, they prayed, and as they prayed, angels were released because his deliverance needs the hand of an angel. Moshe klatole katole bande kita antole bakati ketele bahaya. I pray for your children, Lord. Whatever their deliverance is, whatever the need of their deliverance is, Lord, you know. Therefore, by the power of the Spirit, by the power of the Holy Ghost, we dispense the anointing, the power of God to bring a change in their situations. Let their life change. Let things begin to happen for them. Let miracles take place for them in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We give you praise. Oh, we give you praise. Now, stretch forth your hands towards me as I bless you this week as you go. Moko meklan ko shikle telelelebea. Ozimako maniantosi velekushata. In the name of Jesus, by the ministry of the Spirit, I ask that things be augmented for you. Let things be aligned for you. Let things find their right places for you. In the name of Jesus, let power be made available on your behalf. Wherever you have been hemmed in, we break the power of the enemy. I release into your life the power of God to cause changes. In the name of Jesus, I break the hold of the enemy. I destroy every hold of Satan and darkness over your life. In the name of Jesus, I release grace. I release grace. I release grace. Go and be helped. Be marvelously helped this week. Be marvelously helped this week. Let every pain around your neck be destroyed now. Begin to do what you could not do before. I release the healing power of God through the medium of TV, through the medium of the airwaves. I declare now, be healed in your body. Be healed in your body. Be healed in your body. I curse fibroid.
I curse every growth in your body. I cut it out now in the name of Jesus. Ear infections, I command them to go. Eye problems, I command them to be mended. I command weakness in the body to be adjusted. I declare now, receive the power of God. Receive the grace of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Thank you very much for being part of today's service. And I will see you on Wednesday. Love you and shalom to you. God bless you. See you soon. It's been AJK here. Bye-bye. Shalom.
If you're not sure that you are born again, but you want Jesus to be resident as the Holy Spirit, he says, soon you will not see me. That's his death. But he says, soon you will see me because I go to the Father. The only way we can see him is through the Holy Spirit. If for any reason you want to receive Jesus into your heart, I want to pray for you quickly now, wherever you are. Just pray this prayer with me. Declare with me, Father, let the Spirit of God come into me. Let me not be the same. I ask, O God, that make me a new creation through the work of regeneration, through the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Father, I receive into my spirit a new spirit. I am a new creation. From today, I refuse to be the son and the daughter of the devil. I receive from today the spirit of sonship. Therefore, I take dominion. Thank you for the gift of salvation. Thank you for the gift of salvation. Father, I ask that the Holy Spirit will come into me strong in the name of Jesus. Now pray this prayer, declare me in the name of Jesus. If you don't speak in tongues, declare me in the name of Jesus. By the evidence of speaking in tongues, I receive the infilling of the Holy Ghost and with the outward manifestation to begin to speak in tongues now in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, I receive the gift of speaking in the Holy Ghost now.
I went across the deep blue sea, couldn't find one to compare to your grace, your love, your mercy. Nobody greater than you.